Firstly, I want to thank the Sheldon Shamir Foundation for inviting me to talk this evening on the rule of law in an age of terror. It is truly an honor to follow the footsteps of someone such as Sheldon Shamir, who was committed so strongly to the protection of civil liberties and human rights. And of course, I also wish to thank Rick for being the driving force behind my attendance here. The focus of my talk tonight will touch upon a number of themes. And hopefully by the end of my talk, I will have challenged you to question whether the concept and the practice of justice is being carried out in your name. I will also comment on Omar Khadr and Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, as they are both interlinked, and one considers human rights and the rule of law. And his story, in my view, touches upon so many issues, from the human to the inhuman, from the legal to the illegal. I could simply say that I have never ever represented anyone whom I feel has been so abused and so abandoned by so many who should know better. So I've anguished on how I should approach my talk tonight. Should I simply talk about the rule of law and pass myself off as an academic in that area, which I'm not, or give you the dirt on that hellhole called Guantanamo Bay? And in the end, I took the Canadian approach, that of compromise, a bit of both. As a lawyer, I have long viewed law as a powerful tool. Thank you for coming. As a lawyer, I've long viewed law as a powerful tool, as a means to advance human rights and social justice issues. And I know that there are those who see the rule of law in negative terms, as a constraint upon freedom and creativity, as a series of traps for the unwary, as a set of rules designed to stifle initiative and enterprise. They see the Constitution as a means of enabling courts to frustrate the will of elected parliaments. And to some, the rule of law is thought to require the police to investigate and to bring to prosecution every aspect of the rule book, no matter how harmless or incidental it might be. That, in my view, is not what law is about. The rule of law, in my view, is meant to be a safeguard, not a menace. Law can be a great equalizer, whether to promote justice and individual liberty, or as a restraint upon the exercise of power. People everywhere need to be continually reminded that violations of human rights, whether arbitrary arrest and detention, unjust imprisonment, torture, including acts of terrorism, are all threats to world peace. And each violation, wherever it occurs, can set in motion a trend towards the debasement of human dignity. From individuals to groups, from groups to nations, from nations to groups of nations, in a chain reaction, a pattern sets in, a pattern of violence and repression, and a pattern of a lack of concern for human welfare. And the place to stop this chain reaction, in my view, is at the level of the individual, you and I. The individual denied his or her human rights should be our focus. And we as individuals can be agents of change. And it was upon this commitment to the protection of fundamental rights to the most vulnerable in our society that the Charter of Rights and Freedoms was born. And it is because of that commitment we Canadians have an obligation to ensure that the rule of law is applied fairly, particularly to those who are the most vulnerable in our society, by ensuring their most fundamental rights are protected. It is because of my belief in Omar's right to justice, a universal entitlement of every human being, that I set out to assist him legally. I viewed justice not from the perspective of some grand ideal, but something that I felt was real and would be realized. But I was wrong. My journey on behalf of Omar Khayyam had been a sober reminder about the very limits of justice itself. And long before I reached that sad conclusion, I was aware the struggle for justice would be daunting and at much personal cost. But I never wavered in that belief because I felt, and I still do, it was the right thing and is the right thing to do. I recall appearing in the landmark case of Rasool versus Bush in 2002 before the US Supreme Court, where we successfully asserted the long-standing 17th century common law right, allowing Guantanamo detainees to challenge their imprisonment in a properly constituted court. I recall the excitement I felt on leaving the court and later celebrating with others for a job well done. That success and that thrill didn't last long, as the Military Commission Act was then shortly passed to eviscerate the court's ruling. And 9 years later, in 2011, President Obama codified into law the indefinite detention without trial for Guantanamo detainees. And it was only 2 years earlier he had vowed to close Guantanamo Bay. And when this bill, the National Defense Authorization Act, was passed, there were concerns raised by various commentators that the bill would strip the FBI, federal prosecutors, and federal courts of all or most of their powers to arrest and prosecute suspected terrorists and hand it over to the military. All that the legislation would give future presidents the authority to throw American citizens into prison for life without charge. They were correct. This pernicious law poses one of the greatest threats to civil liberties in US history. This law can be used by authorities to detain forever anyone the government considers a threat to national security and stability, potentially even demonstrators and protesters exercising the First Amendment rights. Essentially, what we've taken the responsibility away from the federal court of a portion of criminal law and put it under the military. While back in Canada, my co-counsel Nate Whitling and I, after many years and numerous challenges, successfully obtained two separate judgments from the Supreme Court of Canada involving Omar Khayyam. The Canadian Supreme Court, in a major rebuke, ruled the US treatment of Omar Khayyam in Guantanamo Bay contravened the International Convention on Torture and the Geneva Conventions, and that Canada was complicit in that torture. Surely, there can be no greater rebuke levied against a government, its elected representatives, and others that purport to uphold the rule of law than to have been complicit in something that is both real and horrifying against one of its citizens, especially a youth, namely torture. And it's not the first time that Canada has received such criticism. It was only recently, in the last few weeks, the UN Committee Against Torture criticized Canada for being complicit in the torture involving three Canadian Arab men, Mr. Amaki, Mr. Almaty, and Mr. Nurin, both before the federal court at this present time. And our government dismissed this report outright as being absurd, suggesting the UN had better things to do with its time than decrying Canada. In fact, the interim report from the UN Commission Against Torture had a panel of 10 experts from a range of countries, including the United States. And it doesn't just single out Canada, but includes Canada amongst other countries as part of an ongoing effort to monitor convention signatories. So Canada wasn't singled out. It was just part of a collective involved in torture. Not directly, but complicitly. It's so it's depressing, in my mind, to see the current federal government dismiss out of hand the United Nations' well-reasoned critique of this country for failing to live up to its commitments. And I'm not surprised, as the ruling by our own Supreme Court, that Canada was complicit in the torture of Omar in Guantanamo, did not move our government to apologize on behalf of all Canadians. Instead, they refused the Supreme Court's request to bring Omar Khadr home from Guantanamo Bay. And one really is only to turn back the clock to 2006, when a Canadian Commission of Inquiry, led by Dennis O'Connor, then Associate Chief Justice of Ontario, found the actions of Canadian officials likely led to the rendition of Mahar Arar to Syria, where he was tortured. So how did we arrive here? Considering that our generation has had the most sophisticated development of international laws, treaties and conventions the international community has ever known, and all stating that human rights abuses will not be tolerated. Although it could also be argued that many of these international conventions are more honored in their breach than in their observance. One is only to consider that the United States has been involved in some 40 military actions over the past 25 years, including wars in Iraq, Afghanistan, Yugoslavia, Panama, Grenada, and so on. So I have reluctantly come to the view international human rights law as having a dysfunctional relationship with justice. The rhetoric is beautiful, but it's all dressed up with no place to go. It appears that in the wake of the September 11, 2001, 9/11 attack, many countries, responding to the United Nations security resolutions and public anxiety, began to adopt an increasing array of counter-terrorism measures. For some states that routinely abused human rights in the past, counter-terrorism was simply the newest excuse behind which to hide. For other states, counter-terrorism was claimed to be the justification for departing from long-cherished norms. And ironically, it is those liberal democratic states which lauded the importance of the rule of law and the protection of human rights that are now responsible for undermining those very protections. And these states are not far away. They include our neighbours south of the border, and they include our own government. And as a result, the international consensus reflected in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the Charter of the United Nations that no one in the future would fall outside the protection of the law has been overridden and supplanted by lawlessness. We are witnesses today to disturbing contemporary events, with habeas corpus being abandoned, secret courts being created to hear secret evidence. I walk out of these secret courts. Guilt being fed by association, torture and rendition nakedly justified, and vital international conventions consolidated in the aftermath of the Second World War, the Geneva Conventions, the Refugee Convention, the Torture Convention, and more, have been deliberately avoided or just simply ignored. You've already considered that in today's world, the President of the United States has unfettered discretion to order lethal drone strikes targeting and killing suspected terrorists solely on the basis of secret, unchallenged intelligence information without any legal oversight or due process being afforded to the victim. And many of those drone strikes have hit the wrong targets, killing numerous innocent lives, including women and children, and all explained away as collateral damage. And where is the international condemnation? The use of drones far beyond the traditional battlefield or war zone opens up a question of what constitutes armed conflict, what constitutes a war zone or a battlefield. This distinction matters, as international laws of war and conflict hold that inside an armed conflict, you're allowed to kill people without warning. Outside, you're not. So that makes it pretty important in my mind to know whether you're on a battlefield or not. The problem, of course, is that the current nature of US conflict is unprecedented. We have never had to deal with such extensive transnational armed conflicts where there is such reluctance by governments to test the legitimacy of their actions in a court of law. It doesn't seem to matter that with Al-Qaeda's core in Pakistan usually diminished and Osama bin Laden dead, or that in North America, most people have died from snowmobile accidents than from terrorism as a result of 9/11. We continue to allow ourselves to be exploited by governments who continue to play the fear card of security trumping civil liberties. And we have agreed to a perpetual state of war anywhere and everywhere on this planet, and there are no acknowledged limits. So to dispute my suggestion that I'm overstating my case, it was in January of 2002 that we saw the first shocking images of human beings in rows in aircraft, hooded and shackled for transportation across the Atlantic, much as other human beings had been carried in slave ships 400 years earlier. We witnessed the captors humiliating these enormous human beings and boarded at Guantanamo Bay, Cuba, crouched in open cages, in orange jumpsuits, all deliberately displayed for the world to see. You all saw that on the TV. You saw it on CNN, you saw it on CBC. And for the watching world, you and I, no knowledge of international humanitarian conventions was needed to understand that what was being witnessed was unlawful. This was not a manifestation of the Geneva Conventions at work, nor was it an act of deportation or extradition. It was far worse. It was the unlawful transportation to a world outside the reach of law and intended to remain so. And in that world, crimes against humanity would be carried out in Guantanamo Bay, Cuba. Guantanamo Bay, Cuba has been called everything from an offshore concentration camp to a legal black hole. It has become a symbol of much that is wrong with our society. It is a complex of brutal prisons where hundreds of men have been held by the US under incredibly human conditions and incessant interrogations. And amongst those was a Canadian youth, Omar Carter. And these prisons are a symbol of the disdain with which the US administration has brushed aside long-standing precepts of international law and human rights conduct, and without the slightest criticism from Canada, unlike other Western governments, who all refuse to allow their citizens to remain in Guantanamo Bay, requested their return, and that was granted. And yet Omar Carter spent over a third of his life in conditions that have raised international condemnation from other countries, from human rights organizations, from international jurists, from the United Nations Committee on the Rights of the Child, and so on. But not by our country, not by our governments, not by our representatives. And what I'm saying to you is all familiar to you. You're all aware of it. Those suspected of being terrorists, in my view, and in anybody's view, are not outside the law, nor do they forfeit their fundamental rights by virtue of that fact. In 2010, Omar Khayyam pled guilty in a plea deal, which allowed him the possibility of a return to Canada. And as of September 29th, 2012, Omar Khayyam is in Millhaven Maximum Security Prison, where the recommendation is that he be designated as a maximum security risk and not be eligible for parole for another 2 years. The problem with that type of designation is that in 2 years, when you go back before the parole board, they can't release you because you have not access to any programs which are not given to maximum security prisoners. So I simply view this as the efforts of government to run the clock out. Omar Khayyam was 15 when he went to Guantanamo Bay, and he's 26 years of age in Millhaven. And online news commentators and the nation at large, you and I, have all argued bitterly, at least those interested, on the subject of Omar Khayyam. It was during one of those oversimplified debates, especially amongst journalists and columnists, that the term convicted war criminal was repeated when describing Khayyam. In fact, I was interviewed when I arrived here by a gentleman who asked me what I thought about Omar Khayyam, the convicted war criminal, or the use of that term. And when I heard those debates and I heard that language, it was then that I realized that throughout this case, the Canadian government has successfully legitimized the American justice system. Canada left Omar Khayyam in that hellish place among the torturers, the waterboarders, the held without charge detainees, unprotected by the Geneva Conventions, in an unaccountable justice system for 10 years. In fact, our own Supreme Court said it was beyond the rule of law. And surrounded by these extreme examples of abuse and blatant disrespect for international law, in 2010, Khayyam was charged under the 2006 Military Commissions Act and signed a plea deal. And part of the plea included the possibility of return to Canada, in other words, leaving Guantanamo. And at the end of the road, it was not Canada that demanded Khayyam serve the remainder of his sentence on Canadian soil. It was Washington. And I take time to say to you that there may be times in my life when my mother talked to me about being ashamed of myself and my behaviors as a youth. But I never felt more ashamed in my life, which I carry to this present day, than having participated in the so-called trial of Omar Khayyam. I spent a summer putting together a witness list that included Romeo Dallaire, that included David Crane, UN Special Prosecutor for the Sierra Leone Trials, and various other people. And not one of those individuals, not one single witness was allowed to come in. The only person I was able to get in was Abed Singh, who is a professor at King's University College in Edmonton. And I had her provide me with educational material to provide to Omar so we could educate him while he was in Guantanamo Bay. Omar Khayyam was eviscerated any bloody defense. And I remember in persuading him to plead guilty, I said to him, if you don't plead guilty, you'll spend the rest of your life in Guantanamo Bay. And I had never seen such incompetent counsel in my life as the military commission lawyers that had been imposed on us. But what I did say to him was, we will rehabilitate the public perception of you. Because we have this psychiatrist who has a brigadier general whom we've paid all kinds of money, and he's assessed you for over 200 hours. And we have this New York psychologist who comes from a very top at hospital where she works. Because Omar Khan at all times was concerned that he'd be considered a terrorist, as he is, by many Canadians. And I've made that promise to him. Plead guilty, and at the sentencing hearing, we have these experts will go up. And the night before those experts went up, the Brigadier General came to my little room, which was a little plastic, like a double toilet, on a disused at air base, and told me he wasn't going to testify tomorrow. And I said, you have to. You're a military brigadier general. You're going to be speaking to a military jury. You're going to be speaking to military prosecutors. You're going to be speaking to a military judge, and they will listen to you. And he said, today I was questioned by various security people. But that has got nothing to do with my decision. Neither the psychologist or the psychiatrist went on the stand. Omar Khan, when I say he was eviscerated in any defense, that's an understatement. But we call him a terrorist in a system such as Guantanamo Bay. Who amongst us would not have taken the deal that he was offered? Because at the end of the day, the military jury gave him 40 years. And I remember speaking to that jury, talking about the difference between youths and their behaviors and adults. And at that military commission process, you were able to speak to particular jurors. So I'd ask a question, how do you feel about it? Is there a distinction between making children accountable for their actions as opposed to adults? Each juror said no. There was no difference. So today when I hear the Harper government use the term convicted war criminal to describe Omar Khan, I feel shamed. To say someone has been convicted implies the application of law. When we hear such a phrase, we assume the conviction happened in a legitimate court. We assume the process was fair and just. And when the Canadian government says it, that phrase, convicted war criminal, becomes part of your understanding, part of your language, part of the fabric of national discussion. We're talking about a war criminal. And what happens? What is left? Is an oversimplified debate. Convicted war criminal or child soldier? Erased in that debate are any notions of what Guantanamo Bay represents. Erased also is any notion of Canadian involvement or complicity in Khan's treatment. Three Canadian governments refused to stand up for justice or lawful treatment of a prisoner. They took a different stand. We will not stand up for justice. We will not ask questions about Guantanamo Bay. And we will not challenge the U.S. on what happens at Guantanamo Bay. And as an aside, I've had a lot of success in courts over the years. I have not lost a case against the Canadian government in over all those years. But I lost 35 pre-trial applications in Guantanamo Bay, and not one. So what does that suggest? It suggests I'm incredibly incompetent, or there's something wrong with the system. For the past 10 years, Canada has stood alongside the US and fully embraced the existence of this prison and even participated in it. And while our government has successfully established the narrative of a local convicted war criminal, it should be lost on no one, or certainly no Canadian, that we as a nation endorsed the war crimes committed at Guantanamo to arrive where we are at today. And this is the story of Omar, and it says everything about who we are as a people. The actions of our respective governments have tarnished all of us. And our forefathers would never have envisaged that the history of the new century would encompass the destruction and the distortion of fundamental legal and constitutional principles that have been in place since the 17th century. We appear to have forgotten the lessons of the Star Chamber. We were accused, were submitted to torture, to accusations based on secret evidence, heard by a secret court, while being shackled and held in the extremes of isolation. And the worst excesses of 9/11 should have sounded loud alarms, not the least because of that precise historic parallel to the Star Chamber. So I'm coming to the end of my talk, and I say to you, the health of civil liberties and civil rights in any society is directly related to our willingness as citizens to stand up and to speak out for our beliefs in the public arena. When we cave into fear and apathy, when we fear to speak out in opposition, there are no longer boundaries to state action and impermissible behaviour. And if we walk away from our duty to uphold human values, who will speak for us and our children when our turn comes? Thank you very much.